hold on to hope. And in the coldest evening in this December,
let us pray the spirit of love will linger. Let the world stand still,
let the church bells ring. Hallelujah.
Let the magic warm the moonlit air. Hear the choirs joining, singing everywhere. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Glory, glory, glory. I'm so glad to have you here.
And may this
a soggy, merry, merry Christmas to all of you. It's hard to believe that Christmas is right on our doorstep, and I am so glad that we can spend just a few minutes together celebrating. As I look around the room, I recognize so many family and longtime friends, and at the same time, I know that some of you are our guests here for the very, very first time, and I want to say thank you for being here. My name is Andy. I'm on staff, and if you are our guest, we'd love to extend a Christmas gift to you, whether you're in the lot or in the room, and you can simply go to guest.lakeoconee.church on your phone, and we'll email that gift your way, and it's just a small way that we can say Merry Christmas to you as we kick off this Christmas Eve service. And for all of us, there's some exciting things outside. There's some festive raspberry lemonade. There's some popcorn if you haven't gotten that already. And make sure that you stop by and get your picture taken in our photo booth. All of those pictures will be posted online tomorrow on our social media channel so that you can grab those, share those, post those, and share them. I think I heard somebody posted their Christmas card using last year's photo booth pictures, and it was an awesome picture. So maybe that's an option as you're planning ahead for next year. You may want to do that. But we're so glad that you're here and a part of it. And what's crazy is that Christmas is tomorrow. It feels like just yesterday it was, say, mid-March or something. But I'm just so glad that you're a part of it. And maybe a little bit like me, you're feeling the pressure of some of the things that still have to be done before you accomplish everything that this weekend has in store. And somehow, it's not very much fun to be the person under pressure. But it is kind of fun to watch the person under pressure. So take a look at this.
Two neighbors face off in an epic challenge. Nancy has a Christmas cookie recipe she's been baking since childhood. Lane is a professional chef and will attempt Nancy's recipe. To even the playing field, they will each have a student with them doing the baking. It's anybody's game, so who will win the Christmas cookie challenge?
Let's make our crushed candy cane cookies.
Can you, tell me what the first thing to do on our...
Oh, you probably can't read
cursive.
We're gonna add butter, sugar, and vanilla into the KitchenAid, okay?
Okay. You just shake it or something. There you go. Let's get this little piece off.
And there's kind of a fun little trick you can do. You peel this back, you can just...
That's cool.
It really toss it down in there.
I can't do it quite yet.
Turn it this way so it spouts out there. Okay. All right. Okay, we're almost there. Half a cup. Good job.
Main thing, I think we should do like 4 or 6.
Okay,
you can put up a little bit more. Gotta beat that up really good. There you go. Okay, we don't want the yolk in there, okay? Oops, there's the yolk. Oh, I think we got it. That's our recipe.
Which is covered in flour.
Oh, I hope we can still read it. Do you know how to make these? Yeah.
The fun part is crushing the candy canes.
Oh, yay.
Kind of heavy, but I think you can do it, okay? So you just got to go like this.
This is your special candy crush tool.
Oh, cool.
We've got to do 3 steps. We have to roll them, dip them in the egg white, and dip them in the sugar, okay?
Egg white? Why would we dip them in that?
Oh, it feels weird.
Kind of sticky.
Yeah, it's like Play-Doh.
Play-Doh with chocolate and peppermint in it, though.
Whoa!
We color coordinated our cookies with our sweaters.
Yeah.
Egg white in the sugar, and then on the...
You can never have too much. Sugar.
Right.
We can end up finding a way to win.
Girls always win anyways.
Yeah.
I started making these when I was a little girl. Someone brought them over to my mom, and they've been my favorite cookie ever since. So every year I make them, and my girls help, and we send them to my brother, and they're the best cookie in the whole wide world. These in here. We have to see how much flour you have on yourself.
A lot.
A lot.
My favorite food in Christmas, dessert-wise, is probably Watergate salad.
What is Watergate salad? Did Richard Nixon do anything with salad?
What?
What is Santa gonna bring you?
I think I'm gonna ask him for a puppy.
How would he get the puppy to you?
He's breaking down the chimney.
Barking would wake you up.
I'm a sound sleeper.
So am I.
Let's go check it out.
They look like bombs.
Yeah. I think a few more minutes.
Yeah, those look pretty good though, don't they?
Yeah.
Well, still a little gooey. Guess we're gonna have to go back in for a couple minutes, huh?
Yeah, I think we should take them out.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm gonna take them out.
Looks good.
Mm. Whoops.
Look at those hands. Look at those hands. Think we're going to win? We got to win. Definitely, we're going to win.
With these cookies, I think we're definitely going to beat the girls.
Nailed it.
Well, if you've ever watched one of these competitions, you know that there's typically a judging at the end. And as much as I would love to share these with everyone, they only gave me 3. So let me see by show of hands or honking of horns, how many of you think the guys won this competition? All right, there's some of you. How many of you think the girls won this competition? I think there's an unfair section over here. I don't know about the horns outside, but here's the deal. Instead of a judging, we're going to keep this Christmas cookie challenge going. And here's why. Because the challenge isn't about baking the cookies. The challenge is about sharing them. So if you remember, Nancy said that she's been baking this recipe nearly every year because someone shared the recipe with her family. And today, we're sharing the recipe with you. So as you leave today from the auditorium, and if you look in your bag in your parking lot, you have the recipe that both of our chefs were using as they baked this cookie recipe. And to make it easier, we've also included the peppermint stick that you need. One per family. As you leave today, you'll get this, and that's in your bag as well in the parking lot. And here's what we'd love to ask you to do. Bake the recipe. Bake a batch for yourself and enjoy them as a family. And bake a batch for your neighbor. And because it's COVID, leave it on their front porch and send them a text message. Or get it all ready to bake and text them that the cookie sheet's waiting for them to put in the oven. But share this recipe and a batch of cookies, put the card there with it, and extend this recipe one generation further with your neighbor. And this is just a small way that you can wish even your neighbors a Merry Christmas in the middle of an awkward 2020. Sharon, who do you think won out in the parking lot?
Well, Andy, I think it's unanimous that the ladies have it, right, ladies? That's right. But hey, everyone is super excited about giant candy canes. So we're excited to make those cookies. And we're also excited about singing some Christmas songs. So, Band and Krista, take it away.
Stand up and sing together.
To bed. stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining till He appeared and the soul felt its worth. Thrill of hope, the weary world rejoices, for yonder is the new and glorious morn.
Couldn't help but be amused over the past several weeks and months as it seems that commercials and even mailers have begun with the phrase, "in these uncertain times." And I have to ask myself, when have we ever had certain times? When did things ever go exactly the way that we planned that they would? When were we ever able to predict our health or guarantee the markets or ensure our success? When did that ever happen? When did we ever have certain times? And as you begin to think about the Christmas story and the way it plays out, we've tidied it up so beautifully. And the Christmas story fits perfectly on the front of a Christmas card, and it's so picturesque. And yet the story itself is full of uncertain moments that would leave most of us in despair. And in fact, if you begin to read the Christmas story, you can see very clearly that there's a whole lot of uncertain times in the Christmas story itself. Let me start reading in Luke, which, if you don't know, Luke did a whole bunch of research about this Jesus, and he talked to all sorts of people who were eyewitnesses, and he documented his story this way. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. Now, I can't help but hear those first three words in the original language that they were written in, which I'm pretty sure if we translated it exactly, it would be, "In those uncertain times," no, just kidding. "In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of all the Roman world. And this was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph, he went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. And he went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child." There was no expectation that there was going to be a taxation that required everyone to go back to their hometown. It was an uncertain moment for Mary and for Joseph. And then Mary was expecting a child. And so the whole trip from Nazareth to Bethlehem was an uncertain moment for them. The whole path was difficult and uncertain. But Luke continues. And he said, "While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. And she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. And she wrapped him in cloths and she placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them." They hadn't reserved a 5-star hotel. They hadn't gone on Airbnb and gotten a picturesque tiny house someplace. This was a food trough in a cave intended to look after animals. And that's where Mary gave birth to her first child. How much uncertainty did she feel in that moment? The story continues. "She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night." A calm, quiet, fairly easy role watching over flocks at night. "And suddenly an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were terrified, uncertain, nervous, scared, afraid. This had never happened to them before or anyone they'd ever talked to. Suddenly the sky lights up and an angel is speaking to them. The angel says, 'Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you, and he is the Messiah, the Lord. "This will be a sign to you. You will find the baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." And when the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem to see this thing that's happened, which the Lord has told us about." And so they hurry off again with a great deal of uncertainty. Is this real? Was this a mirage? Did we all see this? What's going to happen? So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was laying in the manger. But could you imagine being Mary and Joseph in that moment? Because suddenly a whole group of shepherds burst in on your birthing room. And you don't even know who these people are. The uncertainty in that moment had to be profound. And when they had seen him, when the shepherds had seen him, they spread the word concerning what they had been told about the child. And all who heard it were amazed by what the shepherds said to them. But Mary, in the middle of all the uncertainty of the taxation and the travel and the birth in a cave and shepherds bursting in with a surprise message that they had heard from the angels. But Mary, she treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. Somehow, in the middle of all the uncertainty, Mary was confident. She was confident that somehow God was at work. Over the past few weeks, we've been taking a few moments to light a candle as we focus on the true meaning of Christmas. In the first week, we lit a candle that reminded us of the hope of Christmas. In the second week, we lit a candle that reminded us of the peace of Christmas. Then the love of Christmas. And last Sunday, the joy of Christmas. But as meaningful and important and essential as all these elements are, they're meaningless without the Christ of Christmas. So today, as we celebrate Christmas Eve together, we reflect on just how important the Christ of Christmas is to us. How important is Jesus to the Christmas story? But perhaps more directly, how important is Jesus to our story? Because we have never, ever had certainty. There have never been certain times. But we do have a certain person. Way back to Abraham, God promised that he would send Jesus. And God orchestrated history until that night in Bethlehem when Jesus was born. And we now look back on that event as a momentous time when Jesus, the Savior of the world, was born as God's Son, lived a sinless life, gave his life, and rose again, proving that he was who he said he was. And you and I have an opportunity. Because I don't know what 2021 looks like. But I do know that even if that year is uncertain, we have someone we can be certain in. And that someone is the Christ child of Bethlehem. That someone is Jesus. So I want to ask you to imagine, what would next year look like if instead of saying, "I'm going to try to make it the best Christmas ever and I'm going to make everything absolutely perfect," What if instead of saying, I'm going to start this year different than I've ever started a year before, and it's going to be different? What if instead of saying, this year I'm going to fix my problems and I'm going to be better? What if this year, instead of all of that, we said, this year, Jesus, I'm going to follow you this day, this one day. And then we got up the next day and we said that same thing again and again and again. We have never had certain times, but we do have a certain person, Jesus. And I would invite you to follow him into 2021. Let me take a moment and pray on this Christmas Eve. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for Jesus. The Christmas story represents so many amazing things, but none of it means a thing if you hadn't sent your son Jesus to be God with us, our Savior, our Forgiver, our Leader, our Hope, our Peace, our Love, and our joy. And God, for many of us, this year has been extraordinarily difficult. And I don't know what it looks like 8 days from now. But God, for each of us, may we pledge tonight to follow you into it, one day and one step at a time. It's in the name of Jesus, the baby of Bethlehem, the Savior of the world, the risen one of Easter, that we pray. Amen. This evening, I want to invite you to reach beneath your seat in front of you here in the auditorium and reach into your bag there in the parking lot and pull out a candle. Because tonight, we're going to light a candle much like we lit the Jesus candle for us as a group. I want to invite you to light your candle tonight as a symbol of saying, I want to follow Jesus into this next year, whatever this year has in store. I'm going to light my candle to say, I'm going to follow this year. And Amy's going to lead us here in just a moment. But if in the room you would light the candle of the person closest to you in your row, and there in the parking lot, you should find a set of matches. And we're going to sing together, recognizing that all that we have to be certain about is Jesus.
I invite you to stand up with us.
Jesus is Lord at his birth, and he is Lord as we go through our daily lives and into next year. And I thank you so much for being a part of this service. You can blow out your candles, and you can dispose of those here in the room. There's some bins by the door. You can drop those in as you leave. But as in just a moment, we're going to sing one more song together. A couple things I'd love for you to know. First of all, there will not be a service this Sunday, as we give that Sunday as a gift to our many, many, many volunteers who help things like this happen. So no services this Sunday. But we will be back on January 3rd, so I'd invite you to come and see on January 3. Keep that in mind. And as we leave here in just a moment, please follow the parking volunteers. They're going to send you to the right of your parking lot and out our back entrance, which is also to the right. And that way we can help the folks who are arriving for the next service to get in as well. But we're going to sing one more song together. We're going to sing Joy to the World. And I hope that you will sing along with us and that your heart will be a part of that. And more than anything, I wish you a very, very Merry Christmas.
Oh, Christmas celebration. We will see you next year, January 3rd, 9:15 and 10:45. Merry Christmas, everybody. Have a great one.